The nature of loneliness. Mother Teresa once said that the most terrible poverty is loneliness, and the feeling of being unloved.
It's about disconnection.
Loneliness is the feeling of being disconnected from others, not necessarily about being physically alone.
It is possible to feel alone in a crowd. Being in the company of good friends is one way to feel connected, but there are other ways.
The key is to feel yourself to be aligned with a purpose, something that contributes to the greater good.
When you become aligned with such a purpose, connection becomes more akin to immersion. It is having a common purpose that you share with other, like-minded people. Nobel Prize-winning playwright George Bernard Shaw, never one to mince words, famously said,
"This is the true joy in life, the being used for a purpose recognized by yourself as a mighty one, the being thoroughly worn out before you are thrown on the scrap heap, the being a force of nature." Becoming connected with other people is an inevitable consequence of being aligned with a purpose recognized by yourself as a mighty one, as Shaw put it.
This is not to imply that you should give up on having friends in the conventional sense. The two scenarios complement each other. When you are with friends, you become a like-minded group which generates a strong sense of being connected to them.
In the absence of friends, you can substitute alignment with a purpose recognized by yourself as a mighty one.
It does not have to be one or the other, both is better. The need for acceptance.
In human societies, and in many animal societies too, the need for social connection exerts a shaping influence on behavior.
Our need for acceptance constrains our behavior to conform with the behavioral standards of the group. We pay for our place in society through that willingness to conform, to play the game. If we break the rules, the group imposes escalating disciplinary measures.
At first, we are ridiculed, then excluded temporarily, then ostracized or expelled altogether.
In some societies, nonconformists are put to death.
Social exclusion today is not usually fatal like it was in the evolutionary past. Back then, exclusion meant dying from exposure, starvation or predation. Although losing the will to live is a not uncommon result of extreme social isolation.
The harshest punishment in prison is solitary confinement.
Neuroscientists have mapped the activity in people's brains when they are engaged in a range of activities. It is clearly seen that when people cooperate with each other on worthwhile projects, the reward center of the brain lights up.
We feel emotionally nourished through that sense of productive connection.
Close cooperation in teams calls for specialized skills. Mirror neurons in our brain promote cooperation, turning a group into a team by helping us to empathize with the other members of the team. To look at people and feel what they are feeling, experience what they are experiencing, albeit in a second-hand way. It is our ability to cooperate that is a primary reason for our success as a species. When we combine empathy with the ability to communicate complex ideas, it is possible to achieve as a team what could not be done by an individual.
Why we have big brains.
In the evolutionary sense, our need for social inclusion is one reason our brains have grown large. Anthropologist Robin Dunbar famously proposed his social brain hypothesis, wherein the relative thickness of the neocortex, the recently evolved outer layer of the brain, rose as social groups became larger. This enabled individuals to keep track of the complex set of relationships necessary for stable coexistence. For example, the tamarin monkey has a brain size ratio of around 2.3 with a social group of about 5 members. The macaque monkey has a brain size ratio of around 3.8 and has a much larger social group of around 40 members. Given the brain size of humans, Dunbar estimates we have an expected social group size of around 150 people, which not uncoincidentally is about the size of an extended family or clan.
People on the spectrum.
With people on the autism spectrum, their cognitive resources are redirected away from the default setting of social interaction into areas like mathematical processing, allowing them to perform prodigious feats of calculation but at the expense of being able to empathize with others or understand the subtle nuances of social interaction. Seen in the grand context, this is no bad thing.
People on the spectrum have contributed disproportionately to human civilization.
In every society, there will be those pensive ones who think up new ways, and then those who work with others to bring those ideas into existence.
We need both kinds. Sir Isaac Newton, for example, was very likely on the autism spectrum.
His desire to interact with people was very limited, but his ideas are among the most transformative in the history of science. It was the gregarious Sir Edmund Halley, of comet fame, who ensured Newton's ideas reached a broader audience. But even the most introverted among us need social connection, though the degree of need will be considerably less than the average person.
Everyone has their optimal level to find. Loneliness is a signal.
A different perspective on loneliness is where we see it as a signal from our psyche that we have become dysfunctionally isolated from our social environment, and that we need to reconnect.
Not unlike a low battery needing to be connected to a charger to bring it back to full potential. In the past, that would have been as simple as rejoining our tribe or finding another.
Reconnecting today might be more complicated given the greater mobility and ease of modern society. People live far from their families in places where they feel like a stranger in a strange land. It might also be that the complexities of modern life is creating a degree of anxiety in people generally, leading them to withdraw into the relative safety of their domestic cocoon, reluctant to venture out. These folks will likely compensate by living more of their lives in the online world. There will be various reasons why more people self-describe as lonely. These might be two of them. The fact remains that feeling lonely is a signal to find a way to reconnect with a sense of meaning.
Situations that cause loneliness.
While the underlying cause of loneliness, disconnection, can occur across many life situations, there are some that entail a higher risk.
New environments where you don't know anyone, and no one knows you. Where people are different in the way they dress, the way they talk, the things they do. Where there are different social customs. You feel like the proverbial fish out of water.
Moreover, people seem to be established in their friend groups, and the no vacancy sign looks to be out. It might be that you have no intimate partner, someone to share your innermost thoughts and feelings, someone you can reveal your private self, someone you can trust to not hurt you when you reveal your true self. The need for intimacy exists beyond the need for sex, which is more biological than emotional. Isolation, if you live in a remote area with few or no other people nearby. Ironically, it's possible to be isolated in a big city with thousands of people nearby. The emotional barriers that people in crowded cities erect to protect themselves from strangers can certainly create a sense of isolation.
My animals, cats and dogs and other companion species that humans have cohabited with for many thousands of years provide much emotional support and do so in a completely non-judgmental way.
Our pets have evolved to instinctively want to be with humans and give unconditional love.
Strategies for reconnection.
If you are interested to know more about how to reconnect, you might find the book Being Alone helpful. There's a link in the description below. The book outlines a series of strategies to help you find your own optimal kind of reconnection. Some of these strategies come directly from evolutionary psychology. We might live high-tech lives, but under the skin, down deep in our instincts, we are still similar to our distant ancestors.
What worked for them can work for us now.
If we were somehow able to take a human being living 100,000 years ago, clean them up, give them a shave and good haircut, dress them in modern clothes, they would be indistinguishable from anyone else walking down a city street. Their cognitive abilities would in some ways be superior to our own, since not writing things down or recording them means they needed to remember more. Looking at the world through the lens of evolutionary psychology is a powerful tool for understanding why the world is the way it is, why people behave as they do, and how we can solve some of the more difficult problems that face us.
Thanks for listening.